Amen. Welcome to Shiloh tonight. Praise the Lord. I tell you what, I feel the Holy Spirit here tonight already. I'm telling you, it's been awesome this week, ain't it? But we want to welcome you tonight. I want to welcome you that's on iChurch looking tonight. We just thank the Lord for you. I don't know what you come to do tonight. I've come to praise the Lord. Amen. Amen. Yeah. Worship the Lord tonight. Amen. You know, the devil had a plot to take us all out. You hear what I said? A plot. But what's he wanting to do? Steal, destroy? He wants to kill us, don't he? But I'm glad that Jesus had a plan. Amen. Our Father had a plan. Amen. That he sent his Son. That we could have salvation. That we could be free tonight. That we could have joy, peace tonight, God. Thank the Lord that we're in the house of the Lord tonight to worship him. It's been a good week. I want to thank Brother Mike for being obedient. I'm telling you what, he's preached the word. Amen. And I'm going to tell you what, it should have got on all of us. I tell you what, I didn't know. I knew there was a lot of fish in the ocean, but I didn't know there was that many fish in the house of the Lord, brother. Amen. That was an awesome word last night. All of it's been good, but I tell you what, been praying today and asking God just to have his way in the service tonight. But, you know, we got to do something. We got to get involved. What we need to do is we need to forget about everything that's gone on today. They miss everything that's been happening around about us and get our minds on the Lord. Because when they were in the upper room, they were on one mind, one accord. And what happened? Oh, the Holy Ghost coming like a rushing mighty wind. Amen. I believe that's going to happen tonight. Do you? Amen. Let's give the Lord praise in the house tonight. Amen. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. We just love the Lord tonight and thank him for his many, many blessings upon us. He's so good to us and he's done so much in our lives. And we all have so much to thank the Lord tonight for. Amen. If you have a request, not lift your hand. Amen. Praise God. God sees all the hands tonight. I'm not going to ask for outspoken requests, but God knows your heart tonight. God knows what you need tonight. Amen. And we're believing that he's going to meet our needs according to his will. Now, let's stand at this time and let's worship the Lord. Just pray to him tonight and ask him what you want for him tonight. And we want to remember Brother Mike tonight. I know he's got a word for us. Amen. But let's pray that God will just give him a great and a mighty anointing tonight like he's never had before. Amen. Praise God. Let's pray at this time. Father, we just thank you for this day. Father, we thank you for the opportunity. Thank you, Lord, for the privilege, God, that you've given us tonight, God, to come into the house of the Lord tonight, God, to worship our Father tonight, God, and to cry out to you, Lord, God, and to give you thanks and give you praise, God, for who you are tonight, God. Thank you, dear God, Lord, because we know, God, that you're able tonight, God, to do what you need to do in this place tonight, dear God. And Father, we come against anything tonight, God, that would try to hinder this service tonight, God. We rebuke it in the name of Jesus, and we take authority over anything tonight, God, that would show up here tonight, God, and to keep us, God, from receiving that blessing, God, that you have for us tonight. Father, we ask now, God, that you bless Brother Mike tonight, God. We pray, God, a great anointing upon him tonight, God, as he preaches the word tonight, God, and it will settle on us, God. And God, when we leave this place tonight, God, we can know that we've been changed tonight, dear God, Father, and we're ready to follow you, Lord. We thank you. We praise you, Lord, and we honor you tonight, God, and we welcome the Holy Spirit in this place tonight, God, that it might move among your people tonight, dear God. Lord, those that need to be saved, God, to be saved tonight. Those that need to be sanctified, God, to be sanctified. Those that need to be filled with the Holy Ghost tonight, God, that you'd fill them up tonight, dear God. We love you now, God. Those that might be suffering in body tonight, we ask you, God, to reach out right now, God, and touch them, God, that they'll be able to worship you in this service tonight. Father, we pray for Donald tonight in the hospital. God, we'll continue to lift him up to you, God, knowing, God, that you're working right now, God, and we'll trust in you for a miracle, God, in his life, God. We praise you right now, God, and we thank you for what you're doing, God, Lord. We don't understand everything, God, but we know that you're in control tonight, God, and you have a plan, God, for our life tonight. We give you honor now, Lord. We give you praise for what you're going to do in this house tonight, God. For it's in Jesus' name we pray, and the church said, amen.
Y'all may be seated tonight. We're going to open up with a song tonight because I feel like there's some people in this house that are going through a storm. I got one person going through a storm. Raise your hand if you're going through a storm right now. But who knows the master of the wind? Who knows who the seas and the sails controls them all? No matter what kind of stuff you're going through, there's some good in it. You may not see it, but it's there, I promise you. Because he'll take out of that bad the good and propel you to somewhere you've never been before. I pray this song be a blessing to you, especially to you.
I have journeyed through the long dark night, out on that open sea. By faith alone, sight unknown, and yet his eyes, they were watching me. The anchor holds, though the ship is battered. The anchor holds, though the sails are torn. Now I have fallen on my knees as I face the raging sea, but the anchor holds in spite of that storm. I've had visions and I've had dreams. Well, I've even held them in my hands. But I never knew those dreams would slip right through. Well, like they were only just grains of sand.
You know what, church?
You see the anchor holds, though the ship is battered.
Sing it, church.
The anchor holds, and though the sails are torn. Now I have fallen on my knees as I face the raging sea. You see the anchor holds in spite of that storm. Now I have been young, these eyes have seen. But it was in the night, through the storms of my life, oh, and that's where God proved his love to me. See the anchor holds, though the ship is battered, the anchor holds. Although the sails are torn, how I have fallen on my knees as I face the raging sea. You see the anchor holds in spite of that storm. Now I have fallen on my knees as I face that raging sea. You see the anchor holds in spite of that storm.
Somebody say amen.
Amen.
Amen. You know, it's amazing to me how God will just take you back to things ever so quickly. And I don't think it was the influence of the fish. Even though I appreciated that message. My Lord, how mercy did I appreciate that message. But when Nathan was just talking about that anchor hose, it's like the Lord just picked me up and carried me back to a place. Me and my dad used to go down below Elizabeth Town and fish below the lock and dams. He had a wide boat. My daddy was crippled, and my brother had bought him a wide-bottom boat, and he could literally sit on one side of it, and it wouldn't dip water. And so it was very safe to go up in that turbulent water because we always caught fish up in there. We would drop our anchor out in that river over on one side. And as that water was rushing out of that place, I'd say, "Daddy, I think we're drifting." He'd say, "Oh, no, son, we're not drifting." I said, "But Daddy, how do you know?" And he'd said, "Son, mark you a spot and you'll know the anchor holds." Now see, what he done was he picked him out a tree or something on that riverbank, and he dropped that anchor and he marked that spot. And it didn't matter how turbulent things got, he knew we were still. Church, I want to tell you, in the midst of the turbulences of life, you better have a spot marked, and his name is Jesus Christ. Because when you got your eye on him, you know the anchor holds. Because if you're basing your circumstances on the events that are going on in the world around you today, in our lives on a daily basis, because, as Brother Linwood said, we have an enemy that is seeking to kill, steal, and destroy. But I got my eye, amen, and the anchor holds, hallelujah. We give God glory and honor and praise for that tonight, amen. Amen. He's still there, amen. He hadn't gone anywhere, and you've not gone anywhere either, because he still got you, amen. It's been a great week this week, and Brother Mike, every time I hear you preach, I think, well, that's it. I've got the best now. That's going to be it. But I've learned now from this period of time spending around you, you somehow seem to find another one, thank God, and the Holy Spirit. And so I'm just really excited tonight, because if you're going to top these that we've heard already this week, it's just going to be sop up good tonight then. Amen. So we're looking forward today. If you don't know what sop up good means, you're over here in Sampson County now. See me after church and I'll tell you. Amen. We want to go to the Lord in prayer, and there are many requests. But first, I just want to thank God. I want to thank God for our women. Amen. My wife come home today, and she said, "We didn't even get to our study today." I said, "You didn't?" And she said, "No, God just took over." Amen. And, amen. And you can just feel it. Can't you feel it, Brother Mike, when you step up here? Amen. You can feel what these ladies are doing here on Wednesday, and I appreciate it. I think she said there was 11 of them here today, and oh, we praise God for it, and we know. Sister Kathy, if you're watching tonight, we welcome all of those on High Church, and if you're having a privilege to watch this service, I just want you to know you don't worry, because God's got you, amen. And God's got Donald, amen. And God ain't done yet, amen. Thank God, too, as well today. Brandy came through her surgery, and things doing well. Got a text message earlier today. Got her home. Now, I know there'll be a few days of recovery there, but we're just believing God for good things there as well. Continue to remember Brother Chris as he's still recovering from his surgery, and he and Sue, just keep them in your thoughts and prayers, and I know there are many others. But this prayer we're about to pray tonight is for this immediate service, because we just want God to speak to us here tonight. Amen. We just want God to speak to us. We want God to have access to our hearts to do in our lives that He wants to do. Because you see, I'm convinced revival is about me being revived. Amen. If souls are saved in the process, that's all great. But revival is about me being revived. Amen. And I want to be resuscitated by the Holy Ghost. Amen. I want the breath of life and the Spirit and the unction of God to go and do. Amen. To be resonated deep within my heart that I can move forward from this revival and see what God's going to do. Amen. Will you stand and join me tonight? We want to ask God to do just that. And I just want to remind you this Sunday, our series will be continuing on with part two of A Better Way. There is a better way. Last Sunday morning, we talked about the fact if you don't like who you're becoming, amen, there's a better way. This coming Sunday, amen, we're going to be talking about the fact when you're too busy for what matters. Amen. Do y'all know there's something that really matters? There's a better way. Amen. And I'm just going to drop this nugget in your spirit tonight. The life you're living may be keeping you from the life that you really want. So just let that marinate in your spirit for a few days. Amen. And we're going to address that on Sunday morning. Amen. But we want God to do a thing in our lives here tonight. And I just want to invite the Holy Spirit here to do that. Brother Mike, we love you, and Sister Jamil. Sister Jamil, by the way, is at the home church tonight. Their pastor had surgery, I think that was, and she's filling in for him there tonight. We miss her, but we just thank God that they've been with us this week. Brother Mike, we love you. This is always home, second home to you. And we mean that. And by the way, I'll just go ahead and say it. I think I told some of you last night. Might have announced it last night. But next year, homecoming. Amen. The Mills family is going to be here with us. Amen. Bringing song and the word. I don't know if I mentioned that, but we want the song and the word. Amen. So we'll be talking more about that. Amen. But we're looking forward to that if the Lord tarries. Amen. If not, we're going to be singing Glory Land. Amen. Get there, brother. I may just join you in a song. Amen. He's picking at me about singing with him tonight. Amen. I told him he waited till the last night to ask me to sing. Amen. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you. God, I just can't say thank you enough. Thank you, Lord. Just seems so inadequate. But it's all I've got. It's all I have just to offer to you. For your many blessings. God, when I think about how good you've been and how good you are and how good you're going to be, I'm overwhelmed. My praise just seems so inadequate. God, I love you, Lord, tonight, and I thank you. I thank you from the depths of my heart tonight for who you are. And I thank you, Lord, for who you allow me to be in you. You are the great I am. And I thank you, Lord, for inviting me to be a part of your family. Making way that I had access to be able to call you Father. Inviting into a relationship where my elder brother said, you just simply call me friend. God, I love you, Lord, tonight, and I thank you. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for what you're doing in our midst and what has been done. But I believe the best is yet to come. And we celebrate that tonight here in this room. You have access to us, Lord. And we just give you that tonight. We don't have to offer that to you, but you have access to us. And we want you to know tonight you have liberty in this service to do that you desire to do. Father, we just come to worship you tonight and say thank you. We come to glorify you. We come to honor you tonight. God, I believe that you're going to honor your servant tonight by anointing him again with a fresh anointing. And I pray for Brother Mike tonight, God, that you'll do that thing in his life tonight in such a way, God, that he'll be able to bring to us exactly that you've laid on his heart. May he speak as the very oracles of God under the anointing of the Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name that we do ask these things tonight, giving you glory and honor and praise. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Father. Amen and amen. Before you're seated tonight, this will be your last opportunity this week to be able to say to Brother Mike and Sister Jamil, we love you, we appreciate you. And I'm a firm believer in doing those things, but then I'm also a firm believer in the fact that we ought to put legs on those things. Amen. And we do that by showing our love through our generosity to them. And we want to do that again tonight. And we're going to do it in the same manner that we've done it all week long. And that's exactly what we want to do here again tonight. I just want to invite you, as Brother Nathan is playing, I want to give you an opportunity. Brother Mike, I don't think I've done this before, but I'd like to ask you, if you will, just to come down front here, stand out front. Not to see what's coming to the altar. But if you will, just come down front. I'd like for the folks to be able to just come by and just bless you tonight. More than what we can do for you financially, just to say, and I know we're social distancing, so please don't grab him and get in his face, but you can love him from a distance away. We love you all, giving you this opportunity to love him. This will be the last time this week that we get the privilege to be able to do that. So if you will, stand and join me in giving a good old Sampson County welcome to our brother, Mike Mills. Love you, my brother. God bless you.
Amen. God bless you. Now, before you're seated, I want you to turn around to the person that's standing next to you and look them right in the eyes and tell them, you sure look good in God's house tonight. Tell them. Tell him you look good in God's house tonight. It's your season to be blessed. It's your season to be blessed. A little more monitor.
God made you a promise. You stood the test. He's gonna open the window and pour you out a blessing. It's your season to be blessed. Help me sing it. It's your season to be blessed. God made you a promise. You stood the test. The windows of heaven, He'll pour you out a blessing. It's your season, yeah, to be blessed. Listen, I'm blessed in the city. I'm blessed in the field. I'm blessed going out. I'm blessed coming in. He's gonna open the window and pour you out a blessing. It's your season to be blessed. If you're blessed, help me sing it. It's your season to be blessed. God made you a promise. You stood the test. The windows of heaven, He'll pour you out a blessing. It's your season, yeah, to be blessed. Listen, I've been through the fire. I've been through the flood. But I'm standing here just because of His blood. He's gonna open the window and pour you out a blessing. It's your season to be blessed. Help me sing it now. It's your season to be blessed. God made you a promise. You stood the test. The windows of heaven and pour you out a blessing. It's your season. It's your season. It's your season to be blessed. All right, give him a hand of praise for that tonight. Amen. The Bible declares, for in due season we shall do what? Reap if we faint not. That don't mean that like you were out in the cotton field when we were growing up and you got too hot and you fainted. That's not the kind of faint that he's talking about. But this faint is interpreted to mean when we lose heart, when we give up the fight of faith. I liked a song Brother Nathan was practicing on earlier, and I was hoping he was going to sing it tonight. That song said, I've come too far to look back. Amen. How many has come through too many valleys, through many dangers, toils, and snares, and you can't look back now? Somebody say, I can't give up now. Amen, amen. Gonna sing a song that's featured, gonna be featured on our new CD we should have out in a few weeks, Bueller Land. Listen. I'm kind of homesick for a city to which I've never been before. No sad goodbyes, I like that, will ever be spoken. Time won't matter. It won't matter anymore. Help me sing it. Beulah Land, I'm longing for you. Oh, yes. And someday on thee I'll stand. there my home shall be eternal. My heavenly home. I'm thinking about heaven. I'm looking for a river. It's a bright crystal river. There my faith, it will end just inside. There's just a few more days we're gonna have to labor, then we'll take our heavenly flight on home. Give our Lord a hand of praise for that. Beulah land, I'm longing for you. And some sweet day, on thee I'll stand. There my home, my home shall be eternal. Beulah land, sweet Beulah land. Help me sing that chorus one more time. Beulah land, for you, my God, I feel the Spirit of the Lord in this place tonight. When I begin to talk about heaven, when I begin to sing about heaven, it makes me homesick to want to go. They're my home shall be eternal. It one more time. Beulah land, sweet Beulah land. Amen, amen. Amen. Jamil often picks at me because I like those old songs. She says, the old guy likes the old songs. That's all right. She's the one that married the old guy. Amen. I miss her tonight, and I certainly thank you, Pastor Eddie, for your understanding. The pastor of my home church just recently had a surgery, and he asked if Jamil could fill in for him tonight. And that's where she is. She's very dedicated to our home church. If we're not in revival, we try our best to be there on Wednesday night. So you're going to have to put up with me right by myself tonight. And I've been known to act up when she's not around. When I came in tonight, and I believe it was Brother Jack back there, he asked me, was Sister Jamil here? I said, no, it's just me and Pastor Eddie singing tonight. You should have seen that look on his face. And Pastor said, brother, that would be truly signs and wonders. I want to thank you for coming each night of the revival. There's not another church, and I say this, and I want to choose my words carefully because I don't want you to think that I'm saying this tonight, and then next week I'll say the same thing at another place, because I hope you know me well enough to know I'm not that type of person. But on the average year, we're invited to anywhere between maybe 60 to 85 different churches. But I can't think of one that I felt more loved and more part of the church family than I do right here at Shiloh Pentecostal Holiness. Amen. I really mean that with all my heart. And we love y'all, and I feel like you love us. Like I said the other time, I said, if you don't love me, y'all are some of the best hypocrites I've ever seen. Because I feel the love. Amen. And I told Brother Phil and Sister Betty that our hearts, our prayers are with you. I walked in and I spoke to her, not realizing, because she had the mask on, not realizing that that was Sister Betty. I spoke to her last night, and then tonight she didn't have the mask. And I said, I felt like I didn't greet you right, knowing what you've recently gone through. But Sister, we just sang that song just a moment ago, No Sad Goodbyes, when we're in that sweet Beulah land. Can you say amen? If you have your Bibles tonight and would like to read along with me, I invite you to turn with us over into the New Testament, Gospel of Luke, chapter 7, and beginning at verse 19 through 23. In just a moment, we'll stand to honor the reading of the Word of God. Luke chapter 7. I'm going to ask if Brother Linwood, if you would, Brother, would you get me a cup of water, just tap water, but not refrigerated. My throat feels like it's got a frog in it, and I think he just crossed his legs. Should have included that in that fish message. While some are still turning, and we'll stand in just a moment to Luke chapter 7, in verse 19, let me mention, and many of you have come by each night. You don't realize how much that helps us, but you've come by and visited our ministry product table. And we were hoping to have our new CD back by the time we came to Shiloh, but it's just a few weeks away. In fact, a couple has already pre-ordered it, and we've got your address, and we'll mail it out to you. If you'd like to do that, let me know. But let me tell you, we've got this Christian Message t-shirt right here, and it says, pray. That sounds like good advice for the church. But Pastor, the part that I like is it says, if my people, which are called by my name. Now, somebody always asked me, Brother Mills, why don't you put the scripture reference on there? I said, because when I don't put it on there, or more often than not, I have somebody to ask me, what does that mean? And I said, I'm glad you ask. And I tell them about Jesus. So please come by there and visit with us. As I said on our first year here visiting with you, when you come by and visit at our table, that is kind of like missions work. It helps feed the hungry Indian children. Now, all kidding aside, I'm ready to get into the Word of God. If you're physically able to stand, may we all stand. Thank you so much, Brother Linwood. If you found Luke chapter 7 and verse 19, say, I've got it. Verse 19, it reads, and John, calling unto him two of his disciples, sent them to Jesus, saying, art thou he that should come? Or look we, or should we look for another? When the men were come unto him, they said, John the Baptist has sent us unto thee, saying, art thou he that should come? Or in other words, are you the one that prophecies have spoken about for so many, many years? Are you he that should come, or look we for another? And in that same hour, he, Jesus, cured many of their infirmities and plagues and of evil spirits. And unto many that were blind, he gave them sight. And then Jesus answering said unto them, go your way and tell John what things you have seen and heard, how that the blind see, how that the lame walk, the lepers are cleansed, the deaf hear, the dead are raised, and the poor, the gospel is preached. Blessed, hear this, verse 23, remember this. Blessed is he whosoever shall not be offended in me. Blessed is he whosoever shall not be offended in me. Right before we bow our heads and go to our Lord in a word of prayer, I told you last night, I believe this might be one of the most unusual messages that God has laid on my heart, but I know that God has laid this on my heart. I'm not going to say this because I'm the messenger, but simply because it's his message. But if we'll take to heart what God has given me to share with you tonight, it has the power to break strongholds. We'll see souls won to the kingdom of God. We'll see the kingdom of God advance forth in leaps and bounds. You'll understand what I'm talking about. Blessed is he whosoever shall not be offended in me. Right before we pray, I want to speak to you tonight on the thought, breaking the power of offense. I know it's going to get quiet. It's going to get real quiet. It might even get ugly. I've learned how to hit and run. I'm pretty fast for a short guy. Breaking the power of offense. May we bow our heads and go to our Lord in a word of prayer. Brother Chris, would you lead us in prayer and ask God's blessings? Thank you. Help us, God. Help us, God. Anoint me, God. Anoint me, Lord. I can't do this without your help, Lord. Help us, God. Open our hearts, Lord. Open our ears, Lord. Amen. And you may be seated. Breaking the power of offense. Being offended, it can happen so easily. Sometimes we can be so sensitive that we're offended, and we don't fully understand why. Early, I'm going to just be very transparent with you. Early in our marriage, and Jamil and I this year, we celebrated 38 years of marriage. She was only 5 years old when I married her. Early in our marriage, I had an issue with being so sensitive that I would be bothered by every little thing. And you know how some couples, they go through that silent treatment. Fellas, look straight ahead. That's the only way you'll survive it. Don't look at her now. And there were times that I would be offended. I would be ill and bothered by things. I'd go to bed offended, and I'd wake up the next morning and wonder, now, am I speaking to her or not? I'm just being very transparent. And God helped me with that. Out of petty bickering. If I wanted my marriage to grow, if I wanted our love to grow, I had to get beyond myself. Lord, I pray tonight that you would help me through your word to be a scalpel. Surgically removing things in our heart, in our lives. Now, let me get on point. In our age of political correctness, it seems as though that sometimes we feel like we're walking the tightrope or we're walking, tipping on eggshells because we're so afraid we're going to offend somebody. We're going to offend this group. We're going to offend that group, that we feel like we're just tiptoeing around, and it seems that someone somewhere will declare that they are offended. A man or a woman in political office can be on the threshold of winning an election, and all it takes is one wrong word, and people are offended, and it all goes downhill. Celebrities, professionals such as doctors and lawyers and so on, they can be at the top of their careers, and all it takes is one careless remark, saying it at the wrong time, and someone is offended. And it seems like it all falls apart. Professional athletes, reporters, the list goes on. Their careers can be derailed by one wrong word. Because this is an age in which people can be so easily offended. It's like they wear their heart out. You've heard the old cliche, wear our heart out on our sleeve. But nevertheless, what's really sad is that it's even more evident, more prevalent. It's creeping into the holy house of God. I knew it was going to be quiet there. Amen, Brother Mills. It seems like the spirit of offense is creeping into the house of God. In my travels, it seems that God's people are being overcome, invaded by, infected by the spirit of offense. There are people who were in the church. Now, folks, I've got to say, I love you enough to say what God has laid on my heart, but let me first qualify. I've not talked to your pastor. I've not talked to your church board. I want to qualify that. You all know me better. You know them better than that. In fact, a commuting revival, we've been commuting back and forth. It's a rush down here, get here in time, get everything ready, and get ready to get on the platform and sing and preach. And then at night, drive back home. Try to get a few hours rest. Get up, start studying and doing it all over again. So I've not had even time to talk to somebody. But there are people who were in the church, but now are no longer involved. Now, when I say in the church, I don't mean only or necessarily the Shiloh church, but I mean the body of Christ, the church. They're no longer involved. They're sitting at home on Sundays because somebody offended them. Somebody hurt their little old feelings. Now, I'm not trying to be insensitive. Certainly, somebody truly may have been wronged in this account or in that account, but the spirit of offense. If we're not careful, the enemy will blind us and use it to divide the kingdom of God, to use it to weaken our ministry efforts. There are people who started out with zeal and with vision, but now they're sitting at home offended. Like an athlete sitting on the bench. Like a professional football player, but he's on the injured list. His Achilles tendon has been injured, and even though he's big and strong and he has all these incredible statistics, he can't even get in the game because he's hurt. There are even preachers who once functioned in their calling, who once operated under the anointing, but now they're bitter. They're cynical. They're sitting on the sidelines because somebody offended them. Somebody hurt their little old feelings. Yeah, it happens to preachers too. Amen. Amen. Brother Nathan, I should have given you a pocket full of amens and to drop them for me. There are singers and church workers filled with power and with promise, but who are no longer functioning in their calling. Why? Because somebody offended them. It seems like they waved the white flag. They tossed in, thrown in the towel. You know, like in a boxing ring, when you throw in the towel, that means your fighter, he's done for. He's had enough. He can't take anymore. And it seems like we've waved the white flag, or we've thrown in the towel, and we've called it quits because somebody has hurt their feelings. Somebody has offended them. Now they sit wounded, bitter, not even realizing, hear me church, not even realizing that they've fallen into the trap of the old age attack of the enemy called offense, being offended. Now, before I go any further, I want you to turn to your neighbor and look at them and ask them, has somebody offended you? Look at, has somebody offended you? Has somebody hurt your feelings? Chances are you're talking to somebody who has been hurt, because we all have been. We all have been. So I'm not saying that we've not been hurt. But are we going to allow the enemy to use that to cripple the mighty army of God? We'll never sling a sword. We'll never fight fire a shot as long as he can cripple us with the spirit of offense. You see, one of the most powerful and deceptive traps that the enemy is using to paralyze the body of Christ, the church, that's you and me, is the spirit of offense. What do you mean, offense? Brother Nathan gets up here and sing. Everybody shouts when he sings. When I get up here and sing, you can hear the crickets chirping. I'm offended. God help us. Petty bickering in the holy house of God. You see, the spirit of offense is not only one of Satan's most subtle traps, but it's also one of his most successful traps. It works most of the time. It's an effective tool because the way in which it disguises itself, it has the ability to appear right. What good is being right if you're right by yourself? Nobody wants to be around you because you're so sensitive. They're tipping around on eggshells because they're afraid they're going to hurt your little feelings. I'm going to push this up the hill right by myself. Now they sit wounded. It's a trap. So easy to walk in because it's a very thin line in seeing what is right and realizing that someone has been wrong and actually falling prey and victim coming under the spirit of offense. Now hear this. I found out in many ways the spirit of offense is like carbon monoxide. There was a man in our tribal community. I want to choose my words carefully. He would travel to the many different powwows, not only in North Carolina, but in other states. He would go on the powwow circuit. He was a vendor, a leather craftsman. One of the powwows was kind of out in the country, so he didn't get a hotel room. He decided he's going to sleep in his van. And he left the engine running. And he didn't crack any of the windows. And carbon monoxide poisoned him. He never smelled it. He just fell asleep and never woke up. It's a tasteless, odorless killer. That's like the spirit of offense. You don't ever really see it coming. You don't even really smell it. You certainly can't taste it, but all before you know it, everybody's offended, and it begins to affect and infect others. Amen. Amen. Yes. And understand, when I'm amening myself, it's not because I think I'm doing a great job, but God's word is right. Like carbon monoxide, it's colorless, it's tasteless, it has no odor, but it can be extremely fatal. And the sad part about it is that many people have fallen under this trap, and they're totally unaware that they've fallen in bondage to it. Somebody say, help us, God. It has the ability to sneak up on us, and before we know it, it has our minds, it has our attitudes, all right. It affects our mindsets, and it eventually affects our behavior because we've been offended. Brother Chris didn't shake my hand. You let him get up there and try to teach a Wednesday night Bible study, I'm going to walk right out on him. Because I've been offended. Help us, God. I believe we grieve the Holy Spirit. I believe God the Father is saying, I did not send my only begotten Son to die on Calvary, so my blood-bought church would have to deal with this. Wake up, army of God. There is a spiritual battle to be won. There is a fight going on. There is principalities of darkness. I feel the Spirit of God as I say this. But we've become so preoccupied with past things. Things that are over with. Things that happened yesteryear that we miss the moment. And fail to see what God is wanting to do right now. Because Brother Chris hurt my feelings in 1972, but I didn't forget you, brother. According to the dictionary, and you know I always like to refer to the dictionary, to offend is to create resentment, hurt, or displeasure. It implies causing hurt feelings intentionally or even unintentionally by wounding someone's feelings. So, Brother Keith, even though you didn't intend to hurt my feelings, I'm so sensitive that it hurt me. I'm so sensitive that you can't even walk by me. You're afraid to walk by me because I'm so sensitive. God help us. The Greek word, hear this. Boy, this is a nugget here. The Greek word for the word of offense is scandela. The Greek word for the word offense is scandala, in which we get our modern day word scandal from. Originally, I like this. Originally, this word refers to the part of a hunting trap. A hunting trap in which the bait was attached. Turn around and look at somebody and tell them, don't take the bait. Tell them, don't take the bait. Satan's trying to bait you into a trap. Don't take the bait. We need to understand that the devil has designed this trap in such a way that it's intended to do two things. Number one, to cause great pain and to wound us. Pastor Eddie, when you preached, you weren't trying to single me out and to wound me personally. You were just trying to obey God. But I'm so sensitive, I took it personally. But when the Holy Spirit inspired it to be written in the holy canon of Scripture, it means it applies to me and everyone else. Secondly, it is intended to cause us to be hindered in our Christian journey. Amen. But I came here tonight to declare in the name of Jesus. I came here tonight to declare it in the name of Jesus. That anybody who's been bound by the spirit of offense is going to see that spirit broken in the name of Jesus. Going to see that spirit rendered powerless in his great name. I've learned that even the best of Christians can struggle with the temptation of falling into the trap of being offended. Oftentimes when we look at characters of Scripture, we have a tendency, we do, we have a tendency to look at them as being super saints or something other than ordinary people that God chose to work through in an extraordinary way. But they were ordinary men and women just like you and I. And we often fail to understand that they were flesh and blood just like we are. And there is none in Scripture that was used in such a manner as John the Baptist that we read about in our text. But even as great as John the Baptist was, even he struggled at times with certain things. John the Baptist, the one who stood in the waters, and only he, hear me church, it was only John the Baptist that could say that he baptized the very Son of God. Pastor, it doesn't matter about your minister credentials or mine. You nor I can say we had the privilege of baptizing the very Son of God. But John the Baptist, even in light of that, he struggled. John the Baptist, with all his accomplishments and accolades, yet he was so humble that he said about Christ, he must increase and I must decrease. But yet, praise be unto God, we find in our text that he's battling with being discouraged and even offended. I'm encouraged by the fact that the Bible lets us know that great men and women have struggled with their issues, but yet God still can use them. That lets me know in my weak, frail condition, sometimes I take one step forward and seems like I stumble two steps back. But God said, I can use even you. I can put my anointing on you. I can touch you, Mike Mills. You come from a family of alcoholics, but I chose to put my anointing on you to preach my gospel. Somebody give him praise. It is all God. That lets me know that God is able to use me too. Even with all your struggles, he's able to use you. Even over those things you need to overcome, he's still able to use you. Even after the times that we've fallen flat on our face. Anybody ever felt like you're falling flat on your face? It's a wonder my nose is not mashed. I've fallen flat on my face so many times. He lifts us up and says, I still see something on the inside of you that I can use for my glory. Sister Wanda, he can still use us even though we may have stumbled and made a mistake. We have an advocate with the Father. He'll forgive us, he'll cleanse us, and he'll make us usable for his glory. Well, so here in our text, we find that John the Baptist is locked up. His crime, Brother Linwood, he's guilty of preaching the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. He's been faithful. He's been obedient. He's been so bold enough to even call out a powerful king concerning his adulterous acts, in which that led to his arrest. He sacrificed everything for his kingdom assignment. And yet now we find him in jail. You've got to understand, I shared with you the other night when I shared the message on Sunday evening, I believe, transition from the water to the wilderness. That was John in the water. That was Jesus in the water. Now Jesus is going all over the countryside, healing the sick, raising the dead, healing the lepers, and John is in prison. They even have a family lineage. They're distant cousins. But here's how the power of offense, the spirit of offense, can work. John is in his cell. You know how we get sometimes, want to have a poor, pitiful me party. Nobody wants to do right but me. Nobody wants to clean the church but me. Can I push that wagon a little bit? Nobody wants to clean the bathroom at the church but me. Nobody wants to work with the youth but me. And then we get offended. I talk to nobody. I may be way off. I'm just using for example. Now John the Baptist sits in prison and the devil is tormenting his mind. And he sends some of his followers, his disciples, I want you to go to this Jesus of Nazareth. I know I'd sit there in the water and I said, behold, the Lamb of God that takes away the sins of the world. But why don't he come down here and deliver me? He's getting sensitive. I know I stood there. I even heard that thunderous voice from heaven that says, my beloved son, in whom I am well pleased. John said that. He heard that rather. And now he's struggling with offense. They've forgotten me. I'm thrown away. I'm in prison. So Jesus deals with the issue. In fact, Jesus says a few things. In our text, we find John sending that messenger asking, are you the Christ? You're not doing things like I thought you would. Are you the Christ? Pastor, you're not doing things like I thought you would. Singers, you're not singing my song like I thought you would. He sends a messenger, are you the Christ? Or should we look for another? And Jesus says a few things in between, but when he gets to the end of his message, hear this, he concludes it with this. Blessed is he who is not offended in me. Well, Jesus knew what he was going through. He knew the fiery darts that hell was firing against John the Baptist. So Jesus deals with the issue of offense very briefly. I want to take a look at that tonight and explore this throughout our text and see how we fall into it, how we can avoid it, and how its power can be broken from our lives. I'm not too proud to tell you, even in being in the ministry 31 years, if we're not careful, the spirit of offense can rise up. Can rise up. Number one, if you're taking notes, you might want to write this down. Because you're going to need it. Number one, how do we avoid the spirit of offense? Number one, remove our misguided expectations. What do you mean, Brother Mills? Well, in the case with John the Baptist, he had misguided expectations of Jesus. They didn't think that God was going to send a lowly babe in a manger. They thought, I said it the other night, they thought that God was going to send a conquering king to overthrow the Roman government. So he has misguided expectations. We're often taken captive by it because we fail to expect it. Even in growing up in the church, we have a misconception that there's not going to be any offense in the church. I'm in the church. Nobody's going to offend me. Nobody's going to hurt my feelings. They can get offended by what you wear. And I'm not talking about anything improper. I wore a blue coat. Somebody's mad. That is blue, isn't it? Yes. Or everything will go our way and then we're offended when it doesn't. And want to take all our marbles and go back home. Like children on a playground. And some are even surprised when this happened and greatly offended. May I suggest to you people that the reason, now I say this in love. May I suggest to you that the reason that you might be surprised is maybe we've not taken time to really get into the Word of God. For example, Jesus himself said, in fact, I want to turn to it in Luke chapter 17 and verse 1. You can turn to it if you'd like, but I'm going to turn and read it. Luke 17 and 1. Then Jesus said unto the disciples, it is possible, but that offenses will come. But woe unto him through whom they do come. In other words, he said to his disciples, it is impossible that no offenses. Don't you think for a moment that you're going to live in a world, you're going to go to a church where somebody's not going to be offended. Somebody's little feelings are going to get hurt, whether you intend it to or not. Offenses will come. Look who's saying this. Jesus said it is impossible that no offenses should come. Look who's saying this, the very Son of God himself. From this, it's quite clear that we know offenses will come. Out of the very best that you try, somebody's going to be offended with you. Somebody's going to take issue with you. Offenses are a part of our everyday life. We can't live without being offended. You cannot live without offending somebody, whether you intend to or not. But even in our best of intentions, you're going to offend somebody. But I'm not leaving us out there hopeless. Offense happens. If you take a stand, somebody will be offended. If you don't take a stand, they're offended because you didn't. If you speak up, they're offended. If you remain silent, they're mad because you didn't take a stand. If you're friendly, somebody say you're a flirt. If you're not extra friendly, they're saying you're stuck up. Lord, this is hard. It had even gotten back to me. Brother Jonathan, you might have to mute this from the live going out. I don't want Jamil to hear this. I'm going to bribe Sister Tammy and these other ladies. But word had gotten back to me that a church we had visited a couple years ago, there was somebody saying, that Mills family, they're just trying too hard to be friendly. Something's up with that. And you know what? At first that wounded me. It did. Because it's just my natural personality. From the very first time we came here, I reached out. I got to know everybody. Tried to. Felt like family. But then for somebody to be offended because I was being friendly. To be suspect, what's he so friendly for? That I almost fell into that trap. That tasteless, colorless, odorless carbon monoxide of offense. Somebody say, help him, Jesus. See, and it's not just with strangers. Sometimes even your closest friends may be offended with you. Sometimes your church family may be offended with you. Your spouse may be offended with you. Even Jesus himself, he offended people. The Pharisees were offended with him. His own town, when he came back and spoke the words of truth, they were offended with him. His own family, his brothers and sisters, they got offended. I say this in love. She's going on to be with the Lord. When I first started in ministry, Pastor, my mom, she didn't want me to travel distantly. She said, why can't you go to churches just around here and stay where mama can come see you? I said, mama, because there's only three churches around here, I'd starve to death. His own family, his brothers and sisters were offended. The problem with many of us that we came in church and we came with misguided expectations, thinking that we were going to be exempt from being offended. If you think that, you're not looking for church. You're looking for Fantasy Island. Grow up. Can I say it again? It's the last night. Grow up. Get over yourself. The church that our Lord Jesus Christ died for should not have to tip around worrying that we're going to offend or hurt somebody's feelings when we speak the word of truth. We need to be able to speak the truth and not worry about somebody getting mad, going home, withholding their tithes and offerings. No, I'm not paying my tithe to the Shiloh Church this week because Pastor Eddie preached on something I didn't like. Well, let me tell you something, brother. Your tithe and offerings is so that God can bless you. The work of God is going on with or without your or my little offering. Brother Linwood, he just allows us to do that so he can open up the windows of heaven. I preached on it here before. So he can open up the windows of heaven and pour us out a blessing. When we joined the church, we did not join a social club. We didn't join a name it, claim it, blab it, grab it. But we joined the church. We joined the army of God. How many of you men or women were in the military services? What do we have? Maybe some that are watching online tonight. And we honor our veterans. We honor our men and women of active service, even active now. But when you were going through boot camp training, that drill sergeant, at some ungodly hour in the morning, he didn't tip in there to your little bunk. Excuse me. I'm so sorry to wait. But do you think you might can get up? You know and I know. Anybody ever watch Gomer Pyle? Brother Terry, Sergeant Carter got in there. He would be wringing pots and pans and he'd say, get up. You're in the Marines. You need to act like a Marine. Well, I believe the Spirit of God is saying, get up, wake up. Stop being a little child. You're in the army of God. We're fighting a spiritual warfare. I don't have time for your little old feelings. Jesus Christ bore your feelings on the cross. We're in the army of God. When we joined the church, as I said, we did not join a social club. We joined the army of God. 2 Timothy chapter 2. You won't have to turn there. I want to read verse 24. Paul said unto Timothy, endure hardness like a good soldier. Verse 24, and the servant of the Lord must not strive, but be gentle unto all men, apt to teach and to preach. He told us to endure hardness like a good soldier. In our text, John had a misguided expectation. He, like so many others, thought Jesus was going to come riding in and overthrow the Roman government. But God's plan was quite different. And now John finds himself in jail and he's offended. Brother Chris, he's asking, are you really the one? Maybe you've sat right on this pew. Maybe since God has blessed you all with this beautiful facility, you've even pondered that thought, am I really at the right church? Maybe because somebody offended you. Maybe because somebody didn't applaud you enough. We need a spiritual drill sergeant. Holy Ghost, wake me up. Shake me into the reality. We're not wrestling against flesh and blood, but against spiritual wickedness in high places. I'm a soldier in the army of the Lord. Would somebody give him a hand of praise for that? Secondly, we must understand the difference between offense and what I like to call escapism. And by that, what I mean is really two categories of being offended. One, those who's really been mistreated. And then there are some who only think that they've been mistreated, but they actually have not. You just got your little feelings hurt because the gospel stepped on your toes. You got your little feelings hurt because you couldn't have all the spotlight. I don't know why I'm preaching this, but I'm obeying God. Because we, if we can get over the spirit of offense, like a mighty army, the church will move. We will win lost souls to the kingdom of God. Basically, we have two choices. We can choose to be easily offended and allow the seeds of offense to take roots in our hearts and our lives. And eventually it will bear fruit. It's a breeding ground for even more anger and hurt. But then on the other hand, if I reject offense and then say, hear this, I'm coming to a close in a moment. If I purpose in my mind that no matter what happens to me, I'm not gonna be offended. Jesus said there's a blessing to those who choose not to be offended. Turn to somebody and tell them, I choose not to be offended. I choose not to be offended. I'm not going to be easily offended. Whether or not they come and ask me pardon, whether or not they ask me for forgiveness, I'm just going to go ahead and let it go. Look at your neighbor and tell them, let it go. Let it go. I'm not going to hold on to my offense. I'm not going to hold on to my hurt. My mind is made up. I'm going to just let it go. I will not fall victim to the trap of Satan's snare. Look at your neighbor and say, don't take the bait. Don't take the bait. I will not walk in bitterness. I will not walk in bitterness. James chapter 1 verses 2. Let me read it to you. My brethren, oh boy, this is enough to make you shout. My brethren, count it all. Help me out, Brother Chris. My brethren, that's you and me, the church. He said, count it all joy when you fall into divers or different temptations. Verse 4, but let patience have her perfect work, that you may be perfect or complete, entire, wanting nothing. Glory to God. My God. Boy, I feel a Holy Ghost fit coming on right about now. As a matter of fact, our response to offense will often be determined our level of promotion. Amen. I got to share this a little bit with you. You remember when the prophet went to Jesse's house to anoint the king of Israel. And Jesse had several sons and some of those big muscular warrior soldiers. But then he had one little shepherd boy, Ruddy. Had a slingshot. Like my son used to say when my son was a little boy, sling snot. And when the prophet had all the sons come by first. No, not this one. No, not this one. No, 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 no. And then he goes to Father Jesse and said, is this all your sons? And Jesse said, well, surely you must have mean had to be one of these, but I got one more, but surely you don't mean him. He's on the far side end of a sheep pasture. He smells like sheep dung. Go get him. And when young little David walks in, I believe the Holy Ghost quickened. in the prophet of God's spirit and said, that's the one. That's the one. David could have had a spirit of offense and said, oh no, don't get me now. You let everybody else parade around here. Now you want me. Oh no. You want me to sing now, preacher. Everybody else done come and tore up your music program. Now you want me to sing. No, but David, the way he handled a spirit of offense determined his level of promotion. The prophet of God anointed him, gave him a post-dated anointing. I feel the Holy Ghost as I say this, because you're sitting close to somebody who might be having a post-dated anointing. God has already anointed you. You've just not walked into it yet. God has already poured the anointing out on you. You've just not come into it yet. So don't you fall victim to the trap of offense. I don't know who I'm preaching to, but I do know God. God wanted me to preach this. Think about it. Somebody's promotion, somebody's blessing could be at stake. I know that you may have been offended. I know that you may have been hurt and wounded, but let it go. Make up your mind, I won't be offended. I've come too far. God has brought me too far. God has great plans for me. I'm not going to be hanged by the noose of offense. Heal the offense. Heal the hurts in Jesus' great name. In our scripture text, Jesus said offenses would come, but woe unto those by which they come. In other words, there are those who will intentionally try to hurt you. You'll encounter it. You'll encounter that. Once somebody wrote on the Mills family website. I didn't know about it until my pastor read it and brought it to me. They wrote a comment that said, I did like the Mills family. I enjoyed their singing. I really enjoyed Brother Mike's preaching until one night he preached and said something about homosexuality. And I didn't like the way he said it. Well, let me say this. I don't remember specifically what he's talking about, but I know if I said that, it was founded. It was based. I was standing on the Word of God. So I'd rather God be pleased with me and you have your little old feelings hurt than for God to be angry at me and you fine with it. As a matter of fact, and I say this and I'm coming to a close, I found out that we can get to a place where God, we get to a place in God where we just love God so much and we love people so much that we will even get on our knees and pray that God will have mercy upon people who have offended us. I've done it. I have done it. Pastor, there's never been a more trying time in my life than right after my dad died. My sister and I had been his primary caregivers. Many times I'd drive back and forth to revival, go back home and stay with him. And I was under so much physical strain and stress. And right after my dad died and some of the hurtful things that were said, I wanted to lash out. And you know how people love to say, I thought you were a preacher. Brother Linwood, that's like putting a bridle on your horse. And I wanted to say, God, Lord, just let me fix this, please. But God sealed my lips. And I got down on my knees and said, God, bless them. Lord, teach them. Lord, let me love on them in a way that they'll see their error. Lord, let me love on them in a way that they'll come to you and say, Lord, fix me. Lastly, regain your focus. Write that down. If you've been affected, infected, hurt, bothered, offended, you've lost focus. Notice what Jesus did. One of the reasons why many of us fall into offense is that we fail to keep our eyes on God and what God is doing. We focus on people instead. We focus on our circumstances instead. When John sent his messengers to Jesus, he was greatly discouraged. He was greatly wounded. He was even offended. But I like what Jesus did in Luke chapter 7 and verse 22. He refocused him on the signs and the wonders of the fulfilling prophecy. He said, go back to that sale room and tell him, blind eyes are being opened, lame legs are being healed, lepers are being made cleansed. So if you've been hurt, if you've been wounded, if you've been offended, refocus. Allow the Holy Spirit to refocus you. Brother Nathan, I'm going to ask you to make your way to the piano and play something very softly for me. Lord, refocus me in such a way that I'm not looking. Lord, in such a way that I'm not looking at those who've let me down, those who've hurt me, those who've offended me. But Lord, turn my thoughts. Lord, fix my vision on what really matters. What really matters is building the kingdom of God, fulfilling the calling that you've placed on our lives, winning lost souls, showing the love of God. Lord, that was prime number one. Jesus said, that's how a lost world will know you're my disciples, is by your love one for another. Folks, I've got more I could share with you, but I feel the Holy Spirit is dealing with hearts even now. And I've learned that when the Holy Spirit says it's ready, if you keep going, you're going to overcook that cake. And nobody's going to want to eat it. And not once have I said tonight that offenses are not real. Your hurt, your wound, your injuries, you felt that. But don't you dare take the bait. I say it again, that the Greek word for offense is scandala. We get the present day word scandal. It refers to a hunting trap in which the bait is attached. Don't take the bait. Why do you think Satan is trying to make you feel offended? Why do you think that even he allows people to cross your path to offend you? Because he really fears the God in you. He really fears the potential that God has placed on your life. Congregation, would you stand with me, please? Pastor Eddie, I like what you said earlier. I agree with you wholeheartedly. You said one of the main and foremost points of revival is to revive. If along the way some lost soul gives their heart and life to Jesus, we thank you, Lord. We seek that. We want that. But I'm here tonight on assignment to minister to church people who've been wounded, who've been hurt, who've been misguided in their own offenses. As heads are bowed and eyes are closed and nobody looking around, I've said it for the last two nights. God has blessed you all with a wonderful facility, so there's plenty of room. if you've been wounded, if you've been hurt, if you've had thoughts of feeling offended, would you step out? Would you let him heal your heart? Would you let him put his healing on your wounds tonight? Because he doesn't want to leave you in that despair. I'm not denying the hurt that you feel, but I'm denying you the chance to stay there. Get up! You're in the army of the Lord. Get up! There's not a soldier that will, a good soldier won't leave a wounded soldier on the battlefield. Get up! So if you've been hurt, if you've been wounded, we'll call this altar a medevac, an infirmary. Would you join me tonight? Maybe you want the Lord to help you to be mindful so you would not offend somebody. Would you come? Maybe you know somebody who once was so active and faithful in the church, but they've been offended, they've been hurt. And God has charged you to speak to them, to pray for them, to overcome that offense. Would you come that God would grant you wisdom? Would you come? Would you come? Would you come? Folks, I'm going to take my time because I believe God gave me this word tonight. I believe God gave me this word. And one of the great offenses could be is we sitting there and say, well, I know it's not me. It can't be me. I'm at this altar too. Because if I'm not careful, I can be offended. Well, I'm a guest preacher. I should be treated like this. I should. Lord, I humble myself in the sight of the Lord. Lord, I'm not looking for man to exalt me. I'm looking only to please you. Will there be someone else? Would you come? In just a moment, I'm going to lead us in prayer. Would you come? Would you come? Maybe there are other needs. Maybe you want to pray on behalf of a lost loved one. Would you come? We bring back these prayer requests. I want to ask some of our ladies of the church, would you come and help pray with our dear sister? We've got room to social distance. As I minister to those that are watching online tonight, Father, in the name of Jesus, minister to those needs, those hurts, those wounded hearts. Lord, you love us so much, you won't leave us on the battlefield. You won't leave us wounded. In the name of Christ. In the name of Christ. God, touch my dear sister tonight. In the name of Jesus. God, heal her hurts. Heal her wounds. In the name of the risen Christ. In the name of the risen Christ tonight, Lord. We'll give you glory, honor, and praise. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus, God, touch Brother Chris, bless him, bless their ministry, bless their home, bless their family. God, heal any hurts. Heal those deep-seated wounds. Let the salve of your spirit just heal from within. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. The Spirit is speaking to my heart. There are some of us that sit back and wonder, why is this one blessed? Why is that one blessed? Because if you're not careful, you're falling victim to the spirit of offense. Even sitting at your seat, in the name of Jesus, I command the spirit of offense, the attack of hell, to break the stronghold. In the name of Jesus. Set your people free tonight, Lord. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. God, I pray for every home, every family. I pray for marriages. God, I pray for our young and our little children. God, I pray for our teenage children. Lord, break that rebellious spirit. Lord, let the love, the teaching that we brought them up in the house of God, let it rise up within them, every home here tonight, Lord. In Jesus' name, in Jesus' name. Even as these are praying, will there be someone that would say, Brother Mills, Pastor Eddie, last night of revival, I put it off every night, but I want to be saved. I want to ask Jesus to forgive me. It's not only about offenses. I've just done a whole lot of stuff. Tonight is your night. While God is ministering to these around the altars, if you're at home, you want to make a decision to accept Jesus. If you believe it in your heart, repeat after me. Dear Lord, forgive me of my sins. Come into my heart. I confess. I repent. I accept you as Lord and Savior. In Jesus' name. Amen. And amen. And amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen. Touch tonight.
Oh, Jesus is here. Jesus is here. Oh, Jesus is here.
Thank you, God of heaven. My Lord, my God.
I'll receive him.
Hallelujah.
Healing is here.
Hallelujah. Right before Pastor Eddie comes, you all know me. You know I'm not one to tarry. I'm not one to try to make something happen. Father, I know you directed this word tonight. Break the spirit of offense. Lord, we'll see the mighty army of God move as we've never seen before. Lord, may we hide this in our hearts. May we go forth. May we get up in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. Can you give our Lord a hand of praise as our pastor is coming?
What a word. Would y'all just take a moment and applaud Brother Mike? It's not easy to stand and bring a word like this, but a word like this is needed. And I'm not going to add to or take away, but God gave me this last week. And didn't know why, but now I know. It's a brief story of two friends who were walking through a desert. During some point of their journey, they had an argument. One of these good friends reached out and slapped the other one. In a moment of rage and anger, the friend that had been hurt so deeply turned and wrote in the sand, "Today my friend hurt me." And they went on their way. A few days later, they found an oasis, a place to bathe. And as both friends entered the water, the friend that had been slapped previously began to sink in quicksand. His friend pulled him to safety and rescued him. So when he got his composure, he found a rock. And he wrote on the rock, "Today, my friend saved me." The friend was confused. And he said, "I don't really understand." So he asked, "After I hurt you, you wrote in the sand, and now you write on a stone. Why is that?" The other friend replied, "When someone hurts us, we should write it down in the sand where the winds of forgiveness can erase it away. But when someone does something good for us, we must engrave it in the stone where no wind can ever erase it." And so it is that the power of forgiveness is greater than the weight of offense. Unto him that is able to do exceedingly abundantly above and beyond, according to the power that is at work in us. But as your shepherd, can I humbly say, the Holy Ghost is a gentleman, and he will not cross a threshold to your heart unless you invite him. There are times in our life when we are offended, and it is legitimate. When I or someone else has said or done something to you that should have not been done nor said, but it's up to you what you choose to do with it. You can write it on a stone, or you can write it in the sand. Only you and God get to determine that. Wow, what a message. Brother Mike, I'm going to say to you tonight what I said to Bishop Jimmy Whitfield one time. Thanks a lot. Because I'm going to go home tonight, and I'm not going to get to sleep much. But I thank you. Because I'm not nearly as concerned about the times I've been offended. This happened. As I am the times that I could have been the offender. Because my Father says, when you've done it to the least of these, you've done it to me. I don't know what it does to you, but to think that I got to go home and lay down tonight thinking that I might have offended my Father. Father, I thank you for this word. I thank you for this revival. Every message has been distinctively different, but powerfully anointed. Father, I thank you for being your child, that I have the opportunity to sit at your feet and learn from you. And for that, I am eternally grateful. I thank you for every person that has been to these revival services, and I believe as well as myself, you have impacted them by your word. Now may we go and glow for Jesus. May we do with the word what needs to be done, and that is adhere to it and become a doer of the word. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Before I let you go, I must remind you of your responsibilities this weekend. Friday night, 7 o'clock, we're going to meet here in this building preparing for Saturday. Saturday is our golf tournament for our caring and giving ministry, which enables us to send missionaries abroad. It enables us to receive phone calls and lights stay on in homes where children otherwise would be in the dark. It enables us to put heat in houses where widow women are sitting otherwise would be cold. It enables us to be the hands and feet of Jesus. And I get overwhelmed all the time because as I put out that we needed potato chips and now we got more potato chips than we know what to do with, but we're going to invest them into the kingdom of God. And that's just who you are, and that's why I love you so much. But I need all hands on deck Friday night. Now, listen, there's some people that will not be able to be here, and we're not going to be offended by that. Amen? There'll be some folks Saturday that will not be able to be there, and we're not going to be offended by that because we're family, and we love one another, and we prove God's love by the love we show one to another. You choose whether you're able to be there or not. And I know already if you can be there, you will be there and you will do everything you can do. Amen. But that will be at Lakewood Country Club. Sign-ups 9 o'clock Friday, Saturday morning. We need all hands on deck no later than 9 o'clock Saturday morning. yes, ma'am. That's right. Yes. Yes. Yeah, we don't need a dozen ladies there at 9 o'clock. Those that are assigned to specific jobs, such as, you know, the selling of the half and half tickets, the giving away of the door prizes, the registering the golf teams, they know who they are. Primarily, the help we need from the church is going to be down at the tent serving the golfers. And, you know, I get raves all the time. All the time. Just people talking about the amazing tournament that you guys put on. And it's just another hands. Another opportunity to be the hands and feet of Jesus. And that's what it's all about. Amen. Preacher, there's nothing spiritual about this. Really? Really? When our Father commanded us to go into the highways and the hedges and the golf courses and the woods and bid them to come in. We're on a mission from the Father. Let's do it, okay? God bless you all. Be sure and stop by and love on Brother Mike tonight. Amen.